everyone, this is Mr. Brass, and today will be a bonus episode while I'm working on a series. Today's show will be on Genesis and an interesting interpretation I've seen. Genesis has been known by scholars like Walter Brueggemann to be a very difficult topic for scholars to engage in. Augustine himself tried 5 times to explain the first chapters of Genesis. Genesis has a plethora of interesting elements, such as there being many divine beings in Genesis 3:22, God threatening to punish Adam with death in Genesis 2:17, and that doesn't just do it as well. It's also the mystery of the serpent and the single forbidden tree. With the serpent, we know that the identification of it with Satan comes from later in tradition and has no support in the text, and the prohibition not to eat of a single tree seems sort of out there with the crime being contrived, and like I said before, the sentence of death wasn't carried out. Genesis can make God out to be a petty tyrant. In today's lesson, I'm throwing out an idea by Joseph Hallman and Paul Duff, which attempts to solve these problems by taking a guardian perspective. To Gerard, a myth is a narrative about primal murder rewritten in the perspective of the killers. The myth seeks to cover up the crime. Examples of this can be found in the North American tale of Ajubawa, whom's death was seen as necessary due to supposedly threatening the community in order to cover up for the fact that his friends drowned him. Gerard also argued that originally the Norse Balder was killed by the gods, but it was shifted to Loki to make it look like it was one man's doing, all done to eliminate traces of collective violence. How does Adam and Eve fit into this? Well, in the paper by Paul Duff on the matter, Adam is a scapegoat whose myth is evolved to conceal the violent elements of the crime. To get at this, we will go to Ezekiel 28:12-19, which seems like it is dependent on a common tradition as Genesis 2 and 3. It seems to be about Adam, whom was in the Garden of Eden, and is subject of Ezekiel's lamenting. Let's read Ezekiel 28:12-19 in the North American Standard Bible version. Son of man, take up a lamentation over the king of Tyre, and say to him, thus says the Lord God, you had the seal of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering, the ruby, the topaz, the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, and the jasper, the lapis lazuli, the turquoise, and the emerald, and the gold, and the workmanship of your settings and your sockets was in you. On the day that you were created, they were prepared. You were anointed, you were the anointed cherub whom covers, and I placed you there. You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked in the midst of the stones of fire. You were blameless in your ways from the day you were created until unrighteousness was found in you. By the abundance of your trade, you were internally filled with violence, and you sinned. Therefore, I have cast you as profane from the mountain of God, and I have destroyed you, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire. Your heart was lifted up because of your beauty. You corrupted your wisdom by reason of your splendor. I cast you to the ground. I put you before the kings, that they may see you. By the multitude of your iniquities and the unrighteousness of your trade, you profaned your sanctuaries. Therefore, I have brought fire from the midst of you. It has consumed you, and I have turned you to ashes on the earth in the eyes of all who see you. All who know you among the peoples are appalled at you. You have become terrified, and you will cease to be forever. In Ezekiel, the Garden of Eden was located on the mountain of God, which in ancient Near East context was the abode of the gods. Ish Abani, aka Stones of Fire, in 1814, is likely referring to heavenly beings whom were a part of the divine council, with primal man being such one, as indicated from Job 15:7-8. This has polytheistic roots, and the mention of the cherubim in the verse of the mountain of God affirms this place as the assembly of the gods, as cherubims were associated with the heavenly court. In a story of the Israelites, one of the cherubs who dwelt in the Garden of Eden on the mountain of God sinned against him and was driven out and brought to earth. As Leslie Allen argued, this cherub was set on fire by the stones of fire, aka the other gods. Ish Waha Waishi Akala Ataka, aka I brought forth fire from your midst in Ezekiel 28:18, gives credence to that idea, so it seems that the destruction of the cherub was the result of a collective, like we know before, and this is a big thing in Gerard tales. Ezekiel, in the Revised Version, attributes the death to just Yahweh, showing an evolution in the story. Ezekiel tells that the first man was morally perfect, but was filled with violence and had corruption and pride, which is to convince the reader of Adam's guilt. It's trying to cover something up. Ezekiel 28:18-19 reveals that the first man was reduced to ashes by the gods, and justifies it by saying he was deserving of death. To summarize Ezekiel, the text strongly suggests polytheism, with the stones of fire representing the gods overall, meaning that this isn't a story of God and humanity, but rather a story about violence amongst the gods and a character who is reduced to ashes by them. For more of the polytheistic form, we can turn to Genesis 3:22, which has Yahweh talking to other divine beings in Genesis 3:5, and that also mentions multiple divine beings, as indicated by the plurality of knowing, as it's about how Adam and Eve will live like gods. So, is this indicators of similar scapegoating story as the one implied by Ezekiel 28? Well, points to the answer being yes, is the threat of death to Adam being repeated three times in Genesis 2:16-17, 3:3, and 4. This is troubling because the punishment isn't death but expulsion, and all attempts to explain this as a loss of immortality is misguided, as the text presumes the opposite. The problem can be solved if the death threat is remnant of the remnant of the original myth where death occurred. Another interesting point is the word ashes used in Ezekiel 28:18 and dust in Genesis 3:19, where each instance these words are used to symbolize destruction of an individual. It is likely that each text points to a common story where ashes occurred and not dust, which we can infer from the fact that dust in Genesis 2:17 interferes with from the pun of the nature of humanity, and it sits awkwardly in the verse, and no mention of dust is used in other parts of the creation narrative. Also, the only other place it is used in connection with humans is 3:19, which is unnecessary as the previous verse already made the same point. It is likely then that the original myth featured death of the individual, so Adam died by the gods, but why? Simply put, envy and rivalry amongst the gods. This can be seen more clear in Genesis 3:22-24, where Adam's punishment is tied to his arousing envy from the gods, and not directly from his transgression. They were worried Adam might eliminate all distinction between humans and the gods, and Adam was one of the members of the divine council and was turned into ashes by the other gods. Genesis 2 and 3 thus suggests that at some time in the past, a community faced with social crisis focused its violence on a single victim, which affected the creation of society, and we make notices of the development of the story. The earliest form of the myth justified punishment by primal man. The prohibition of the tree was added, which also served to justify Adam's punishment, but left wondering if it was a fair punishment. The collective nature of the crime was eliminated by taking out the gods, with only shadows of them existing. The exile punishment eliminated virtually all of the violence, and the final version included the possibly one of the original gods, aka the serpent, as the tempter, and lastly a woman was added in order to shift the blame to her and remove the last remnant of the original elements of the crime. It is fun to note that the woman is not expelled from the garden, but only the man is, showing that the writer didn't include her with consistency. Well, that is all for today. This is Mr. Brass saying goodbye and get wise.